We receive your mail and packages from any carrier, and you can view and manage them through our app or online. This allows you to check your mail from the comfort of your home or anywhere else 24/7. You can easily forward.
Take a few clothes, blow out the fire. Don't be so shy, you're right, you're right. Take off my clothes, oh, bless me, Father. Don't ask me why, you're right, you're right. Hold my stay, I've been coming. Can you feel my heat in your hands? And I'm laying down.
Love me like you do, la la, love me like you do. sun goes down, I'll let you take control. Obviously to white eyes, there it is, face. And I know I lose control of the things that I say. I was looking for a way out, now I can't escape. Nothing happens after two, it's true. It's true, my bad habits lead to you. My bad habits lead to you.
And the myths, the testaments they told, the moon and its eclipse. Superman unrolls, a super fun he lives. But I'm not the kind of person that it fits. But she said, where'd you wanna go? How much you wanna risk? I'm not looking for somebody with some superhuman gifts. Some superhero, some fairy tale bits. Just something I can turn to, somebody I can kiss. I want something just like this.
Sadness. I just wanted you to know. Around my head it calls a magic bell.
just la 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 la. The music is the key, and now the night is gone. Still it goes on and on, so deep inside of me I long to set it free. I don't know what to do, just can't explain to you. I don't know what to say. Oh, not another word, just la 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 la.
Alrighty. Thank you all for joining today. So we're going to go ahead and get started. Everyone's getting settled here in the office. And again, like I mentioned before, we have our training here with StarTech's title. They're going to go over understanding the title commitment. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to you all.
Let us know if people can hear us.
Hello, y'all. I'm Kevin Silver on the StarTech title. Thank you all for having us in. But a few quick points that I wanted to make up before I let Kathleen and Gary take on the presentation is that I left out some handouts beforehand, so I hope that you all have those. And on there, you'll have my cell phone number. I like to make sure that you. That you do have that, because if you ever need something, you can always reach me. I'd like to say that figure if you're working, I'm working too. So evenings and weekends is fine. And on that handout, I also have a list of something I like to call agent solutions. So our parent company has this thing about buying companies that are helpful for realtors and helping with your business. So I'd love to have a conversation with you all about those.
talk about ways that you feel like you may be able to use those to augment your business. And so additionally, we have a location map where we have a number of our offices. We can always help you at any of the Fidelity National financial brands. So Kevin and Gary can close you at any of the locations, including the ones on the location map. But I want to hand it on off to you.
All right. Hi, I'm Kathleen Pierce. I'm one of the escrow officers at our Heights office. I've been in title since 2011. So I know some things. And I've been with StarTex since 2017. And I love the company and I love our office.
I'm Carrie Morrison. I'm Carrie Morrison. I'm also at the same StarTex office. And I have been in the industry for 23 years and on the title side for 20. So it's been an interesting ride.
Yeah. I always feel like I was at State Farm, like we know a thing or two because we've seen
it. Yeah,
exactly.
That's
all I've been there.
State Farm,
don't
sue us.
Again, sorry. But like there's a few things where people surprise us. Like call us with questions, try to stump us. We like a challenge. But to start off, I am gonna go over the contract first. So for my people who are here, is there anyone who has been an agent for less than a year? Okay, perfect. So I'll make sure I dive a little deeper into some stuff for you. So I wanted to go over a couple things that as like a title agent, like we really want y'all to know, because there's some stuff that we're like, please can we put this here? It makes my life so much easier. And one of those things is the seller. We do not want you to use the HCAD name or whoever you see on MLS, please. Ask for their driver's license and style their name as it's written on their driver's license, because that's what we're gonna have to match it to at closing. We would also like y'all to get real nosy and ask them if they were married when they bought the property or if they have married since they bought the property, because there is a good chance that their spouse is going to have to join them in signing, and it's great for them to know that up front. Nobody wants a surprise at the closing table, surprise there for birthdays, not closing. And so that's one of the things that we really want y'all to know, is that starting off from the very top is the seller name, and then getting that spouse's name on there. So Texas is a community property state, so that's why we're gonna need that spouse to sign, unless it's not a homestead property. If they can prove that they have homestead property somewhere else in Texas. Doesn't matter if they have homestead in Boston, we need them to own property somewhere else in Texas to count as a homestead, to show it's a homestead, or else that spouse is gonna have to sign. If it's not homestead property and their spouse doesn't want to sign everything, they can sign something that's called a non-homestead affidavit. And that's where their spouse says, hey, I'm acknowledging that my spouse is selling this property. This is not our homestead. I do not claim this as our homestead, and I have no interest in this property. And they don't have to come to closing and sign anything and just tell us that up front, and we can get it taken care of right away. They can come into our office at any time and get that document signed and notarized. One of the other things that can affect who's entitled is if the person who owns the property is deceased. So then we would really like y'all to put the estate of and then the deceased person's name. If you're getting a property with an estate, let us know once you get that listing, and we can take a look into it to see if, you know, was there a will? Was it probated? Do we see that it was probated? Was it probated in the county where the property is being sold? That matters, because it has to be in the county where the property was sold. If they didn't have a will or probate, we can start working on an heirship questionnaire filled out with who could have an interest into the property. It's a very detailed document that asks for everybody's name, their address, their birthday, and if they were deceased, their date of death. So getting all that information sometimes, especially for big families, can take a while. So it's a good idea to get the ball rolling right when you get that listing. And if we have to like track down kin, that we can start doing that before you go under contract. I had a deal once where there were 27 signers. So many people So few wills. Also talk to your loved ones about getting well. So a death can impact who we want to put as the seller on our contract. Another thing that I wanted to talk about that has to do with the contract is the survey. And so that is where you would mark on page 2. I gave y'all the 1-4 family contract, because that's what we see the most, kind of same section on everything. But so on the bottom of page 2, you have these will be amended or will not be amended for shortages in area. That is just additional coverage for the owner title policy that can be purchased for the borrower. We usually see that in non-platted subdivisions or like meets and bounds locations, or the times that I see it when it is like a lot block survey is when the borrower plans on demolishing the structure that's there and building. That's what I would say I see the most common areas for that coverage. But we do want y'all to check one of those, please, to let us know if they want that, and then to let us know who is going to be paying for that. The other thing is, if we're going to need a survey, if you could please, when you get your listing, ask your seller if they have the prior survey and get that right away from them. Because sometimes if this is marked with the first box that says the seller will provide an existing survey, that tells us that an existing survey exists. So we're not going to be pressuring anyone to order a new survey. And what we've seen happen is every week, I know I follow up with my files like, hey, we still need this. And we'll follow up on the survey. And sometimes we don't always get great communication back, or y'all don't get great communication from your sellers. And then it's a week before closing and the seller's like, oh yeah, I don't have that survey. So, and then that kind of puts all of us on a time crunch to get that new one ordered. So if y'all could help us really push that information and find out, like, don't just mark the seller will provide a new one and then they don't have one. And then we don't know that we get to the closer to closing and we're having to order surveys on it. So we don't have to. The other thing too is that closing date. If you can make sure your seller is aware of that when they sign the contract, because there are so many times we're like, all right, what time would you like to come in? And yes, five. So the closing date. I feel like a lot of times we ask people like, hey, what time would you like to close on this date? Because it's the contract close date. And then people look at us like we have 30 heads over. Mm-hmm. We want to close on that day. I'm going to be in Alaska. So just have people mark that on their calendars, or let us know up front if we need to target a sooner or further date, or if they're going to need like a power of attorney, if they're going to need a mobile notary. We offer those. We have a nationwide notary service for in-person closings, or in some instances we can do a remote online notary closing, which is kind of a secure Zoom. They log in with the notary and they can sign all the documents electronically. For the most part, for sellers, that's not an issue at all. For buyers, if they're using a lender, the lender has to approve that option. And we're not seeing too many lenders approve that. So that's just something we want to keep in the back of our head. If the buyer's going to be a bailout, we need them to sign before that contract closing date. So we have time for the paper documents that are signed to be returned to our office. And we just want to anticipate all of that. And then two other things that as your escrow officer, we really appreciate it if you complete it for us, is on page 8, the contract information.
Yes.
We need to be able to talk to the buyer and seller. There's information that we're going to need from them. And it also helps, Karen, go more to this, but it really helps us with fraud. When you put the contact information there, we know that that's the right email address and phone number that we can be communicating to. We're going to be asking for personal, non-public information. We're going to be sending wire instructions. We want to make sure that's going to the right place and we're talking to the right person. And also allows us to request information to get us closing smoothly if we have that. And it allows y'all to not have to do so much. You don't have to be in the middle of that. We're going to copy you on everything so you see what we're saying to your clients. But that way we can just let them know directly what we need from them. And then the very last thing that as your escrow officer we would like you to fill out is page 9, the effective date. If everything goes smoothly and everybody does what they're supposed to, this doesn't really come into play much. But how many people have had a deal go south and people start getting angry at each other? Well, this effective date becomes very important on when the clock starts for certain things, when things are due, when things have to be received by. So it protects you and your client to make sure that this is filled out. So if your client signs first and then you send it to the other party to sign, make sure they get this completed. But sometimes a lot of times that second party forgets to have that filled out, that other agent doesn't equal to that. So that's very important to us for the contract. So the other two things I wanted to talk about for as far as the contract goes is the addendums. The first one is the addendum for a subject property and mandatory property owners association. So that's the HOA addendum. If your property is in an HOA, we really need this one. This tells us if we have to order a resale certificate. So that's what this top section is. It tells us if we need a resale certificate. Then this bottom section down here, C, that's the transfer fee. That is not the cost of obtaining documents. That is just the cost if the management company charges a fee to transfer the property into the new owner's name. And then down here, D, that tells us who pays for the HOA statement of account if an upfront cost is required. We'll send it to them upfront, or if it has to be collected at closing, who's going to pay for that at closing. So one of the big misconceptions we have on this document is the cost of that statement of account and the transfer fee. A lot of, especially if the buyer's paying for that statement of account, I see a lot of shock at the closing table when we're going over all of the fees, but they're like, wait, hold on, I already paid for the documents. Why am I paying for the transfer fee? That is a separate cost most of the time with HOAs. So that's something I want you to be able to explain to your clients that makes you look awesome, know what you're talking about, and then prevents that confusion at the closing table. I don't know if y'all know this, but there's a website where you can look up HOA fees. Did y'all know that? It came out in the last couple of years. Y'all have my email on my card inside the folder. So if you want a link to look up that website, just shoot me an email that you want that HOA link and I'll send it to you. The other thing I wanted to remind y'all, because of the new law that came out earlier this year, to have those MUD disclosures with your listing. There's also a website where you can look up the MUD contact information and fees. So if you'd like that website, you can send me an email and I'll send you that MUD lookup website as well. So that, and then the other thing I want to talk about is the new addendum regarding broker fees. And this is by convenient opt-turning topic. So make sure it's started. Make sure we get these with the contracts. This is what's going to tell us what it has been agreed to for that selling agent, what they're getting. It's not just on the check contract anymore. We also need this.
Oh, backwards.
Yes.
That's right.
Oh, okay.
Double-sided.
Double-sided. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I also, so y'all have the top, I forgot to say this. We just got so excited to start talking to you. The top copy is y'all's like write all over it copy. And then inside the folder, I have blank, we have blank copies of everything we're talking about. So if you need copies of the forms or everything, you have that in there as well.
Thank you.
So that form's in there and that wraps up the contract. And then the last thing that I'm going to talk to y'all about before I hand it over to Kiri is the settlement statement and how to read it like pro, not just check your permission. So So, okay, I just turned to the front, one of the first documents. So some things that you can double check for your client when you get that settlement statement from your escrow officer are your payoffs. So if you have a seller, right, and you know that they have a mortgage, make sure that their payoff's on there. And then another thing that's going to make you look like an expert is one of the things that your seller is probably going to say, why is this payoff amount higher than what I see when I log into my bank account? The reason being, I know our office for sure, is there's daily interest on the payoff. So what they see is what the is the amount due kind of like at the beginning of the month, and then we're always closing a little bit later, so that daily interest is adding up. And then we always pad our payoffs for a couple of days after closing, just in case something happens, like a derecho hits, or a hurricane hits, or an 18-wheeler runs into the payoff processing center. These are all real things I've seen happen. That payoff is still gonna get paid off in full, and we're not a couple days short interest, and it's not paid off when we go back to the seller if you like, hey, give me $25 more. So we wanna avoid those situations. So we're always gonna pad the payoff on there. There also may be payoff processing fees that the lender charges that your sellers might see. So like the cost to record the release and have that release prepared, those are also on their additional fees sometimes, and that's why their payoff could be a little higher. And then another question that we get a lot in closing is, why am I paying for the homeowners association or the homeowners insurance twice? Because what they do is they see down here, if you look under prorations and adjustments, and then just above title and escrow on that first page. So just above, so under new loan charges and just above title and escrow, you have the escrow account set up. So they're being charged to set up their escrow account. So when taxes become due and the insurance becomes due again, that their escrow account, like their savings account that they're going to have at the bank to pay for those items has enough money in it, they're going to set that up through closing. So a lot of times, people see that homeowner's insurance going into their escrow account, and then they see they're being charged for the homeowner's insurance again on for ours at the end under miscellaneous. They'll see the homeowner's insurance charge again, and they think that they're being charged twice. So that's another time that people look like a rock star and be like, oh, this is for your escrow account, and this is to pay for your policy. And then double check prorations for your client. Make sure the property taxes and the HOA, if there is one, that that's being prorated. Make sure that that's on there for them. And then if there's any contract items, double check that for your client, like if there's a home warranty, if there was a seller credit, make sure that that's being given to your client. So make sure whoever's paying for the owner title policy, that that's the person being charged. And then if they requested that survey coverage, make sure that that's being collected for and paid for by the right person. That's all we have to go over. So that's any questions on settlement statements or contracts? Okay. Well, then I'm going to hand it over to Ms. Carrie.
Thank you. I'm sorry, I do have a quick question. Mm-hmm. So you did say that when we submit the offer, when we submit this,
That's the contract, the buyer's, the broker, that form is automatically submitted together. We would like everything, yes. So make sure your contract and any addendums are submitted together. If you want, I have a list of like almost every addendum that exists, the hyperlink that can take you to it. So even if you have like a solar panel payoff or thing like that, if that's something that we need to know, I might send that to y'all.
So you guys prefer the addendum regarding the broker's fees to be in
with the contract, yes. All together.
And I think, is that across the board, or does it just depend on the title company?
That's probably can depend on the title company. We like to everything to come in at once. That way we know everybody going under contract knows all the terms that they're agreeing to.
Right.
So when they go under contract, they know that, you know, everything's been agreed to for the broker fees, everything's been agreed to for the HOA. Because let's say you go under contract, the buyer didn't realize there was an HOA, and then you throw an HOA addendum at them with all these extra fees, that could cause problems.
Okay, and so, and another thing, I was at an event last week, and some were requiring the buyer's rep, the buyer's rep that we have with our clients, also come in.
That's
it. Was it an open house?
Yeah.
Was it an open house?
No.
You mean with the event?
Yeah.
No. No, we don't use
it. Okay, good. And I mean, some people, there were multiple.
I'm not the real estate police.
It was title companies, loan officers, a little bit of everything.
I don't know, maybe the lenders, I could see them like, hey, I want to prove that
the lender would have to if they're with commission.
But as the title company, we just need to know what the agreed amount was.
Gotcha.
So we know we charge.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. We're going to go over the title commitment. Some really fun stuff here, guys. Let me tell you. It's really, really exciting. So title companies, we actually sell insurance. That's what we're doing. It's insurance for the buyer. So a lot of people are like, they have no idea what title commitment is. They have no idea what title insurance is. Nothing. And I don't blame them. Before I got into title, I was working as a processor for a mortgage broker, a loan officer. I was like, I just need the commitment. I don't know what it did. Why? I just needed it. Give me that commitment. Now I know a little bit more. Thank goodness. So our title commitment is what you're going to get after you get your contract all signed and you come in to escrow. Okay. What we do is we open our order. It goes to our plant. They examine everything, look back from the first time the house was ever built, and bring it forward and let us know all the information that we need so we can transfer clear title to the buyers, okay? The title commitment can consist of Schedule A, B, and C. That's on your title commitment. You'll have a few first pages, about three pages, that are promulgated. They have to cover that every title commitment. The state makes us do it. It doesn't say anything except we're issuing title insurance, who your underwriter is, all that good stuff. Okay, you're going to see it with every title company. Every title company is mandated by the state of Texas. So they're the only fee differences in between title companies are going to be the escrow fee, tax certificates. That's really it. Recording fees are all the same because that's set by the county. So we have very little room to do anything, or no room to do anything on title fees, because we have to follow what the state says. Okay, state board of insurance, that's who we're governed by. And we have a bunch of rules and regulations, just like you guys do, so that we have to make sure that we're following and staying in front of. So Schedule A is what you want to first look at when you get your title commitment. Schedule A is going to tell you who your seller is. This, we hope, matches your seller on the contract. Sometimes it does not, and then we have a whole other issues coming up. But you always want to look on Schedule A. It's always going to be number three on Schedule A. That is who owns your property, or who we're finding vested in title. Okay. Number one on Schedule A, that's just the information telling you what insurance is going to be given, what we're promising to give. So if we have a residential contract, the first thing you're going to see on 1B right there is the owner's title policy. That should be your buyer's name and the purchase price. The owner's title policy premium is based on the purchase price of the property. We can't go up, we can't go down, we can't go sideways. It is based on the purchase price of the property. That's what they get. If you have a $200,000 contract, your owner's title policy is going to cover $200,000. Okay, that's how it works. And if they're getting a loan, that bank is going to require lender title insurance or mortgagee title policy, kind of both of those things. They are allowed to get the loan amount. That's how much that their policy will cover is the loan amount. So Schedule A is pretty easy. We have who we're insuring, who we're going to be insuring the buyer, and who owns the property, the seller. That's it. Legal description is down there. Hopefully that legal description is our property and what you show on the contract as well. If not, again, we have a whole other issue. Don't want to sell the wrong property. It's happened many times. Okay. Schedule B. This can get confusing, but it's not going to be. Schedule B is our exceptions. So every title policy we have, this is what we're insuring and this is what we're not insuring. Schedule B is everything we're not going to insure, okay? There's a lot on Schedule B. Most of it is still, again, promulgated language. You're gonna find out any title commitment in the state of Texas. It's all gonna be on there, okay? B1, those are gonna be all your deed restrictions. We do not insure deed restrictions. So B1 will always be your deed restrictions. And they're not gonna, all you're gonna see are all these numbers, file numbers. Those are where they're listed in the recording in the county records. If you want copies of them, if your buyer wants copies of them, very, very easy to do. Just shoot us an email and we just shoot them all over, okay? Most of the deed restrictions these days, they're not one or two pages. They're about 300. So, and most of them are just signature pages. So it's a lot. It's very, again, very easy to get. And the HOA likes to charge for them. So we can send them over in a link. It's very easy to do, okay? The only other thing you really need to look at on Schedule B is B10. The rest of that, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, promulgated language. Again, you're going to be on every single commitment you'll ever get in the entire state of Texas. So B10 are, again, it kind of lays out more of the deed restrictions and what we find on the flat map. Any easements, drainage easements. You see on this one right here, the drainage easements. It's page 4 of the title commitment. That we're taking exception to. Rights of party in possession. If you have someone camping out on your property and then this buyer buys the property and they say, well, I own this little patch, this square right here where my tent is. We don't cover that. No. So we don't cover rights and parties of possession. Is there, I mean, that, you know, that's happened. Tip doesn't happen often. It's not typical, but it's something that we do not cover.
Is that so, because someone didn't go property?
Right, we do not go view property.
So yes. I mean the buyer.
Yeah, the buyer should go and inspect the property.
They don't do
that. The only time I've ever seen issue with like squatters is tax sales.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Some tax sales.
Or
I've
like,
had a lot of that.
It's like it should be demolished.
Yeah. I work with investors primarily. Do a lot of investors. So a lot of times they'll buy without looking at the property. And then they have to go and evict people and things like that. But again, for normal, when I say normal, is there normal these days? Not anymore. Typically, it's not really a big issue. So really, as an agent, you might want to glance at Schedule B10, see if there's anything out of the ordinary. Like I said, when you see easements and you know power lines, things like that, that's typical to have on any property. You know, so that'll all be there. If you see anything crazy that you're looking at, you're like, wait a minute, what's that? I've never seen that before. Just give your risk professional a call. Very easy. But like I said, this homeowner association stuff will be in there if there's a homeowner association. But Schedule B is pretty easy. Schedule C is what you really want to concentrate on after Schedule A and make sure your sellers are correct. Schedule C is what we say we want to clear. So on the title policy for your buyer, you will have Schedule A and Schedule B. There's no Schedule C on the actual policy. Schedule C is for reference for all of us. Schedule C tells us what liens are on the property, all the information that our examiners or underwriters want us to do to give clear title. That's what Schedule C is. So 1 through 4, again, is going to be promulgated language. You'll find it on any Schedule C in all state of Texas. Number 5 is where you always want to start. And number 5, if they're the mortgage lien, that's going to where you're going to find your first mortgage lien is number 5. On the one we're looking at here, it looks like they have a mortgage lien here. It was done in 2007, and it had a $100,000 loan on it in 2007. That's where we get all the information from, right? Everything's filed in record. So the warranty deed is where we find our sellers. Every warranty deed gives us all of our sellers. Any deeds of trust will tell us what loans are against the property, any mortgage loans or any other loans that have a deed of trust that we would find them against the property. So if you look at number 5, we know, oh, wait a minute, we have a mortgage loan here. We need to get a payoff. That's how we figured that out. Okay. So look at the next page. Lots of substitute trustees. These people weren't paying their mortgage. So you see lots of everything filed of record will be in Schedule D for when it comes to loans, liens, anything like that. So
those secrets.
Yeah. And so the trustee's sale, trustee's deeds, what they're doing are the attorneys for this bank are letting people know, oh, they haven't been paying, we're gonna foreclose, giving all the information that they're required by law to give before they foreclose on the property. So we have quite a few of that. That is all the same mortgage. Even though it's a page long, it's all the one mortgage. Yep, they get transferring to different trustees. They could have 10 different attorneys, these huge banks. Think about Chase and how many attorneys they have.
Right.
So their trustees, they'll have about 100 of them in all the different states and everything. So they just keep transferring them and making sure that they're sending out all the information by federal law that they have to be able to foreclose whenever they're ready to. Okay, so that's what all that is.
Tells us we might need to move a little quicker.
Let's get this closed before the bank takes it. Yeah. So number six, that tells us, oh wait, look, we have another $18,000 mortgage. Again in 2007. So these people must have gotten our first and a second lien when they bought in 2007. So we have the first mortgage payoff, we need a second mortgage payoff as well. They weren't doing too good on that one either. If you go to page 9, here we have some more trustees. So they were sending it to all their trustees to do all their due diligence. Although with a second lien, the first lien holder is gonna go ahead and foreclose before anything else because they have the most to lose.
First lien.
Yeah. So number 7 on this one shows us the homeowners association. Well, they weren't paying their HOA dues either. So the HOA decided to file a lien against the property as well. So that's that one. So again, we'll see builders mechanics liens. We will see liens from your landscaper if you're not being paid. And that's where we will see all of this stuff. And in order to close, we either have to have payoffs or releases to make sure that we're transferring title clearly and cleanly to this new buyer, which is why you have to have insurance in the first place, right? Could you imagine? Hey, Kev, want to buy my property?
Right.
There you go.
And when
the buyer takes on this property, if this stuff isn't paid off and there's no title company,
it's there.
Your SOL.
Yeah. Right. I've seen that at a tax auction before where someone paid a big chunk, $200,000 for a house.
Mm-hmm.
That I guess it was a good deal because it might have been, I don't know, $1 million or $8 million,
right,
or whatever. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, he was like, then he found out.
Right.
Yeah, they had all these things on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Stuff attached to it.
Tax auctions are very scary because foreclosures cut off any liens.
Yeah.
So if this house was foreclosed on, HOA lien be gone. Mm-hmm. It cuts off everything except the IRS.
Except the IRS.
IRS is always going to get their money. Always. But a tax lien does not do that. So the buyers have to be very, very savvy in tax liens. They have to have someone or know how to search the records themselves to see what liens are against the property.
Mm-hmm.
I've had several investors go, can you do this? I'm not looking at 20, and my examiners can't look at 20 properties. We're trying to close deals that are actually going to happen. Also, when you buy a tax lien, there's years you have to wait before you're allowed to sell it to make sure that the redemption periods are all done.
Yeah.
So
we can close them. Ours is 2 years if there's a structure. It doesn't have to be a livable home. If there's
structure. Yeah.
It can be a shed. I found that out the hard way.
Yeah.
That counts. And
so any structure.
A year for vacant.
Year for vacant.
Yeah.
Because they have a redemption period. So we have to get through all of that. We're also going to look at the sellers and their any judgments they might have. If I owe Discover Card $20,000 and they put a judgment against me, they can come and legally they could technically come and take the house if it's not your homestead. Homestead, we have very, very good homestead laws here that don't allow judgment or creditors to take your house, with the exception of the bank or the IRS. And even IRS, it's tough to take your homestead. So if you look at 8 and 9, these are the two sellers. What this means is, hey guys, we find liens that have the same name. We don't know if they belong to the sellers or not, but we need to check it out. So in that case, what we do as a title company and every title company, they'll send a statement of identity, a form for the sellers to fill out that gives us, again, their social, their birthday, their last 10 addresses, all this stuff. So we can rule out, go, okay, I mean, think John Smith is your seller. Do you know how many John Smiths probably have all of this stuff?
The last name was a color.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, black, red,
brown,
I mean, just
green,
everything.
White, like, there's going to be,
yeah, there's a lot. So we have to rule all that out because, again, we don't want transferring to your buyer. And we don't want sellers to come back and get sued or anything wrong with them because we didn't do what we were supposed to do and get that done. Okay. Really, on this one, that's all the liens that you're going to see on this one that we have to deal with. Again, at the end of Schedule C, these are just all things we have to do. This 11 is the company that's going to buy the property. If we have any companies that are buying anything, we have to make sure, or the seller, we have to make sure that they have authority to sign on behalf of that company. We have to see their company documents. For trust, we have to have a whole trust document. If you have a 100-page LLC, we need the 100-page LLC. We can't just have page one showing John Smith is the managing member. We have to do all of that. So we have to look at all of it. We have to make sure that these people have the legal right to maneuver with this property, however, whatever they're doing, if they're buying or selling. So that's always good too, if you have an LLC or a trust or anything, say, just prepare them. You don't need a copy of it. You don't want all that crap.
Yeah,
you know what
like,
I mean?
But the title company is
just let them know, get this ready. This will be needed, but you know, because we have secure way, we keep everything secure in our files, right? It's all encrypted. Blah, blah, blah. You guys don't need all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So just make it aware whenever you're talking to them.
So quick question,
yeah.
Silly question actually, because I don't know if you remember.
Never silly.
So you guys send us all this stuff, Schedule C. Mm-hmm. Once it's clear, we don't get another one saying it's clear.
No.
Okay. And I was going to say, I've never remember getting that. Because
we won't let you close if it's not clear.
It's not clear.
Right.
That's
and think about, so if we're clearing things, if we're paying off, at closing, we can't clear it before it's not paid off.
Right.
Yet.
So you just
said
it's happening.
So the title policy that the buyer will get, that's why there's no Schedule C, because Schedule C is supposed to be clear.
Yeah.
So if anything's not cleared, or if there's anything where there are occasions that our underwriters would be like, okay, we're going to, we can close with this not being clear, but we move it to Schedule B. So we take exception to it. Yeah. Doesn't happen often. And what buyer wants, like, I'll leave that $18,000 lien on there, okay?
Yeah.
No one wants that. It happens. I'm not saying it doesn't. It does, but typically it doesn't. So you'll never have a clear Schedule C. That won't ever happen.
The only time I've had that in the last year was an investor was coming in and they were going to like build, or it was a builder, and they were going to come in and build. And there was a demo lien on the property. And have y'all had to deal with the demo lien, the city, the Department of Neighborhoods? They go slower than molasses and like a Canadian winter, okay? It takes, like, you are not, they don't know what the word brush means.
Yeah.
And so this guy just wanted to get it closed. He's like, you know what? I'll take care of it. I know what to do. So we took exception to it and closed, and he was going to pay to have the demo removed because the property was cleared. It just never got released.
Yeah. So, like, there are instances where it happens. It just doesn't happen. Not with, really. And commercial deals are a whole different ballgame. So other than that, the Schedule C, guys, that's really all it is. Schedule D just tells you who our owner is, who our underwriter is, and the percentage that the title policy is. That's it on the title commitment. It's really not too bad, is it?
No.
It's really not too bad. And hopefully you're closing with a good escrow officer that when they send out the title commitment, they go, okay, guys, here's your commitment. This is what we need. Bam, bam, bam. So it's very easy communication. And not just, here you go, take a look,
yeah.
You know, which I've seen happen before, and that's sad, because we do this every day. The buyers and stuff, they don't do this every day, so they have no idea what we're talking about half the time, you know? So you have to be real careful with that. But, and then hopefully, when you're closing, you can have someone that you can call and just say, hey, you know, what does this mean? Or, you know,
you can always
email or text or call Catherine and I. We're always there too. That's good. Any questions on that?
So with the loan policy,
mm-hmm.
title insurance,
mm-hmm.
could you explain a little bit more what that
sure.
is?
So any bank, any lender that the buyer is going to get a loan from, they request title insurance. So the seller has their policy, and then the bank has their policy. The bank's policy does not help the buyer at all. It's simply for the bank.
Okay.
Basically, if some huge thing comes up and the bank's like, wait a minute, we didn't know that this... We missed a lien,
yeah.
Or the lien got, you know, or didn't get paid at closing.
The property wasn't the seller.
Wasn't the seller, anything like that. That covers the bank. Because it's their own insurance.
Why would a buyer pay back a mortgage on a property they lose?
They don't have.
Yeah. So they won't.
Mortgage fraud is a mortgage. So that's why they, and they're real big on the survey too. And they get survey endorsements to their title policy that we have to make sure, because if there's any easements or anything, if the city wants to go in the backyard and dig up someone's pool, that's going to affect the bank loan.
Yeah, you know.
And so they're real big on surveys and us insuring the survey as well.
Yeah, that makes sense.
So I can go over a survey next. There's one in there. I have a color one if you like that inside the folder, if you'd like to look at that. So I picked this survey because I thought it was just very interesting, and it's just an interesting story. But we can also just go over it and look at it. Yeah, isn't that cool? Okay, so you see on all surveys, you're going to have a compass, a north, so you know where north is on the survey. Okay, you see that graph scale? It's over by the graph scale on the right-hand side on this one. If you're looking at the colored version of this survey, you see the actual property that is being sold is in red, within the red. That's the property. Anything outside of the red is not owned by this seller. Okay. Maplewood is the street, so that's in front on the south, southeast almost. That's the street that we're on. Okay. This one, it doesn't look too bad with easements. Actually, there are no easements in there. You would see lines going through in the middle of the red, the rectangle red box where easements would be. That would show you where easements would lie in the property. There aren't any here. And it tells you, of course, where the house is, the one-story wood frame house. They have a one-story metal building that's to the north of the house. But you see that's outside of the property line. So that's not very good. And then they have the carport. The carport is halfway outside of the property line. And then they have a driveway going into their property is nowhere close to what they own. They also have a fenced in this chain link fence yard where it says Benton Street. That's a chain link fence. So they have some of the front yard, but not all of it is what they own. This one actually did not close.
Right. Like, yeah, you think you're getting that big fenced in yard, and then the survey comes back,
and they don't have anything. They actually asked the buyers asked the seller to remove the carport and push the shed back so that it would be inside the property lines, which the seller did. The seller complied, was like, sure, but then they realized that their driveway is not theirs,
right?
And how do you get access to your property?
Right.
We were going to insure it for the lender. But then the lender was like, wait a minute, you guys are not listening. There is no driveway to your property.
Yeah.
We did do a lot of extra research. My assistant loves to do research and loves to look at the stuff. So we were like, wait a minute, well, who owns that property?
Right.
So we did look in the tax county records. It's abandoned land. There's nothing there. And actually where it says Benton Street, that's not even a street. It's a dead end from the people behind it. So really it's kind of a nothing land. On the right side of the driveway, past the driveway on this side, is the back to another property that's fenced in. So it is abandoned land, but who wants to take that chance?
Yes.
You know, it's a risk because that's a lot of property and a lot of land and a lot of driveway that you don't get to use. Well, you can use, but someone could say, wait a minute, this is mine.
So you can't just survey it and include that.
It's not part of the deed. No, you can't just take property.
No, right?
Yeah. And be like, right, I'm going to go take it. I'm going to survey your house. Yeah. That would be nice.
Yeah, I know.
But we did look to see if anyone's paying taxes on it, or if there's anything, you know, because the seller, and I know the seller, he's an investor that have closed a lot, but usually the sellers, these investors don't get surveys.
This is why you get a survey.
It
shows you what you buy.
Yeah.
I mean, seriously, it's very important. So he's right rethinking his thought process on space. So, but we were like, I wonder if anybody's paying taxes on that. Because he was like, I'll just go buy it, you know, $10,000. I'll just buy it, you know, we'll be done with it. No taxes are being paid. So to actually go with that property, it's going to have to go to the courts. You're going to have to do, the whole nine. And of course, that could take months, months, and a lot more money than he was planning on spending on that. So I don't know what his future process will be now that that has come to light. But yeah, so that survey is very interesting. So what we do when we examine surveys is we of course get the survey and we look at Schedule B and what we have on Schedule B with our exceptions. Remember, I said we don't insure easements, encroachments, things going outside of the property line. We can't insure that. That's not part of our property. You know what I mean? And we're not gonna. Of course, we're not. You know, say you're getting car insurance. You got this big hole in the side of your car. Well, they're not gonna insure that because it's already there. So. That's why we always. That's why the surveys are so important as well. And you know where your fence line is, and 95. They're getting much better. The fences are getting much better nowadays. But back in the day, I think 99.9% of the time, the fence was not on the property line.
It's always off a little bit.
Yeah,
6 feet is a big deal.
Yeah,
right.
Like, and it's like 3 to 6 inches.
Inches, which typically it was.
Yeah, and it's funny because like. Hurricane, a lot of things.
And
so when you put
mine
those
with
mine
and
well,
same. Yeah, I got to rebuild this week. So here's the deal with that. And this is going to be very interesting when houses that had the fence redone are going to be. So fences and surveyors go and they look at the what's in the ground.
Yeah.
Right, they're posts in the ground.
Right,
we
right.
don't see. Nobody knows.
Right.
A lot of these fence companies. They're not, they don't have this. They're not going to do it. So what they're going to do is they're going to follow the line they think the fence is on.
Exactly.
And they're not going to do it correctly. It's going to be off. It's going to be out. It's going to be in. I mean, it's we're going to have a lot more of that after the hurricane.
Right.
Whenever people come selling fences. Again, most of the time, if you have a couple inches.
Nobody's there. Yeah. I was wondering because I just had mine with my fence redone.
Yeah.
And of course they followed the line.
Where the fence was.
I owned all of them. And I'm like, how did I get all of this? But the fence, one half is down this way, one half is down that way.
Yeah.
So we follow the line of the fence and put the posts. But it may be like a couple inches maybe on.
Yeah.
When my neighbor put his part back,
yeah.
There's like this much
right.
of a gap.
Yeah.
And I'm like,
what's interesting, what I found talking to friends and things is did your fence company ask for your survey?
No.
They didn't even think about it.
And that's through
it's
the
like,
years,
that's
though.
Kind of a big thing, you have no idea. And what a great opportunity if you are a little bit this way or a little bit this way to actually get it correct. But fence companies, they don't know. Which is sad because that would have been a great opportunity to actually get it correct.
But again, thankfully, it's only inches, so I'm sure
right.
we'll be fighting over.
Exactly. So surveys are not horrible and hard to read. You just have to know what you're looking for. You know what I mean? Always find the thing that I do first is I'm like, okay, what street am I on? And I find the street, and then you can figure out where the driveway is and where the home sits instead of looking at the picture because you never know where, how, which way it's going. So I always find my street, and then I go from there to find out where what I'm looking for.
Okay, so I have another question. I have a client that bought a patio home.
Mm-hmm.
And one side on his yard, this side is a house.
Mm-hmm.
So does the, and I forgot what the survey looked like, but I don't know if the survey went up to that house. Or if there was some heat before the house. I forget what the survey, but I have more questions, but I wasn't trying to disturb it.
Yeah, but
so,
if you have questions, how else you don't tell unless you ask?
Well, I think for the person that surveyed it,
mm-hmm.
because I wasn't there when it was surveyed.
Typically.
And so would I have a say so in the survey? When
well,
survey,
really,
just
really,
ask
you
questions?
Could just ask questions. Well, I would call
your restaurant
flag
the
corners. Yeah, you can flag the corners.
Mm-hmm.
And usually with a patio home, you're going to have zero lot lines.
Yes.
So the lot lines are going to, but here's the house, here's the lot line.
Yeah.
Boom, boom, boom. So there's not the inch or 2 inch or
right.
whatever. It's usually zero lot lines.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Yeah. That's typically what we see.
Okay.
Sure. Anything else with the surveys? No?
I would mention one thing about the surveys. Because I don't know if you'll see this on the builder's deal, but we'll get builder resales. And then they'll have the section saying, oh, we're going to provide the survey.
And
then they come back and it is a plot plan. And so there's no seal on it. There's no surveyor information that we can trace it back to.
Biggest things that why surveys get denied is one, if we can't read it, I need to be able, my examiner has to be able to read the words. So if it has been had taken by a cell phone and emailed three times as it's been sold throughout the year, we have to be able to read it.
Right.
Like what Kevin just said, has to have the seal and the signature. Or sometimes people scan it in because these will be on legal paper and part of it gets cut off. I don't care if you send me two pieces of paper. I call it arts and crafts. I cut it out and I put it on there and I tape it and then I scan it to my examiner and we all put it together because that's not a big deal. And then, or if there's been a major change. If this house has been demolished and you built a new house, I need to use it.
Is it,
you got it at Google. Or if it was a new build and it just says form here, that is not a final survey. That's where what builders do is when they have the wood before they pour the foundation, they have the surveyor come out to make sure it's not over the property line, that it's in the right place.
Make sure
hasn't been built, the fence hasn't been installed, the driveway hasn't been installed, the sidewalk's not there. So that doesn't count as a final survey. You need everything there. Or if you put a pool in or a shed or something, sometimes we need a new survey. Those are iffy questions, and that's going to be case by case to talk to your escrow officer.
Can you go back on for instance, the patio?
Mm-hmm.
Can you go back and ask questions or inquire about the survey? Or is it because you've already
got it. There's no harm in just understanding.
You can still go back and appeal things?
The deal's is closed. It is what it is. But continuing your education. There's nothing wrong with that.
Mentioning about the seal for is, we've seen it sometimes in contentious negotiations. You provide that and it doesn't have this, it's not the true survey. Next thing you know, your client is wondering why they have to buy a new survey. Why
the contract
says,
the seller says, we'll provide you a survey. And if the lender, the title company, does not accept it, and that would be a reason why we won't accept it, then the buyer has to pay for the new one. And I have seen builders
if that's not there, then you didn't provide it and you're paying.
So it could be if the seller is supposed to be providing prior survey, maybe ask for that before.
At the listing agreement.
Yeah.
At the listing appointment. Yeah.
The only other thing that has to be on the survey is the surveyor has to make a statement that they've made the survey on the ground. They have to actually be at the property to do it. We've had some that they do not make that statement. We cannot. Yes. Okay, since I deal with investors a lot, I've had to deal with a lot of fraud, unfortunately. And unfortunately right now it is rampant. It is crazy right now. Seller fraud is crazy. I have had in the last 6 months, 6 to 7 deals that I've had to stop because the person saying they were the seller was not the seller. They were perpetrating the seller and they were not. And they're very, very good at it. One guy even had a driver's license with a matching and the address on it. Yeah, it's crazy. So a lot of times, and especially now, we still get people that just get very angry because we're like, well, we need this information. We need to verify. We've got to, we have to do our due diligence and make sure that everything is on the up and up. The more people fight, the more we're going to go, wait a minute, what's wrong? Why are you so upset about this? I'm asking for a copy of your driver's license. And I get it. People don't want to send things over because of fraud. I mean, we've heard it all. We've heard it all. I've actually had clients that they've lost their property from fraudulent deeds that have been recorded. I was just notified last week by the Harris County District Attorney's Office that my notary stamp has been used and stolen.
Oh, wow.
It's crazy. That's what people are doing now. I mean, it's insane.
Because you can buy a notary stamp off of Amazon.
You
don't have to prove that you are licensed to notary.
Yeah. It's pretty crazy.
Which is one of the reasons why at closing, we require for you to either come into our office or use one of our pre-approved notary services, I'm not going to let you sign with your notary. I don't know your notary, and I don't know you. But I know that our pre-approved notaries are going to go through certain steps to verify that you are who you say you are.
Yes, and we have a lot of people that, a lot of kids that are trying to help their parents. You're in nursing homes, you're deceased, you're in, I mean, all kinds of stuff. And there's just a lot of due diligence that we go through to make sure you're covered, the seller's covered, the buyer's covered. We have programs that actually we can send to the seller to input information to verify, yes, this is them. So we've done all kinds of stuff. So you just have to be very, very careful. If you're taking a listing, meet these sellers in person, ask them questions. When did you buy the property? When did you, you know, and let me tell you, a lot of them are actually very good. They've looked up all this information. They know it, you know. Oh, it was your mother's property. That's amazing. Did your mother and father live here? Did you ever live in this property? Do you have brothers and sisters? Did they live in the, I mean, anything, just ask questions. The more you ask, the more the safer you're going to be, and the safer that, you know, your true sellers are going to be. So we just need to ask a lot of questions. Buyer fraud isn't as prevalent because now the lenders are so hard on everything. And if you're paying cash, then you're paying cash. I don't really care. You know what I mean? If you're giving money, you can DocuSign. You can head out of matter. It's yours.
Yeah. Send it in.
Exactly. So thankfully the buyers are, you know, we don't have to deal too much with the buyers because the lender does most of that for us, all of it for us, which is nice. The sellers, though, we just have to be very, very diligent. And a lot, especially in this day and age, a lot of people don't want to come into our office. I get it.
Yeah.
I don't want to drive there either. I'll pay $100 to sign electronically.
Mm-hmm.
I'll do the 160. The notary comes to me. Again, we have to go through our notary service. Their electronic, it's called RON, the remote online notary system. It's $100. It's very easy to use. I think it is. If you answer wrong, then they shut it down.
You can verify your identity with like questions about your credit history. So
it's kind of like, did you own this blue car, 1989, that kind of thing. That's what it is. So they have to go through those kind of questions. Did you live on Herkimer Street, you know, ever in your life? That kind of thing. Because they pull a soft credit, so it doesn't affect their credit, but they pull the soft credit so they can get these and credit questions answered and make sure that you are who you say you are. So we have to deal with that a lot. And so when you're doing a listing, just make sure that you actually meet these people in person. Go to the property. Some people, it's land. They're like, I don't need to go out there. Go to the land. Go to the property. Just to cover everyone. To make sure that you're not involved or unknowingly listing a property that isn't owned by this person.
Were you the one who had the listing that we had? They're like, oh, we're going to close at like a online in like the Netherlands and like sent like a picture of the passport, and then like we got the video.
It was somebody
different ethnicity, different sex, like completely different.
They weren't even trying.
And we're like, nope. This doesn't look like Barbara.
Or Ed, go away. And it's that's what they do. So these are videoed. You have to do a lot with them. So that helps a lot. But you still have to, it takes us all. It takes a village. It can't just be one of us.
Yeah, but that's what they suggested to us. If you do, because sometimes you're going to have sellers who are investors and they're selling property and they don't live here. When you don't just talk to them on the email and on phone, do a FaceTime with them. Ask them to hold up a copy of their driver's license and make sure you're verifying who you're talking to as well.
Yeah.
So you're not wasting your time.
I had a seller. I represented the buyer. No, wait a minute. I represented the seller. Okay, so that's why. Seller was great. I represented the seller, and they were still in land. The buyer, I'm like, I was just shocked, I guess, because it was property out in Angleton that the seller owned. And I just drove around in the area just to see who was buying the land and building homes.
Yeah.
It just so happened, was it Blackstone?
Mm-hmm. Blackstone Builders?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, okay, great. Let me see if I can get in touch with Blackstone Builders. But I never did.
Mm-hmm.
And so one day they just approached me to buy the land. I'm like, okay, now let me make sure this is real.
Yeah, exactly.
Because I was just surprised. And so just so happened, I was excited that I saw that when I went in to look in for the person that contacted me, that person was connected to somebody else.
Exactly.
So I did my own
investigation
to make sure that it was a real person.
You have to, and unfortunately, people, I don't know why. I mean, who has time and or the want to do this? You'll have buyers submit whole contracts,
yeah.
And you'll be like, for 2 weeks, where's Ernest? What's going on? And they just are, I don't know why,
yeah.
Just to do it. And
yeah.
It's like, this just, that's horrible, right? Isn't that horrible?
Yeah.
Who's got time?
They don't have anything else.
Yeah, it's sad.
They have time.
It's really
it's
sad.
Their job.
So,
yeah.
So,
okay. Well, great.
So,
okay.
So that's that. Any other questions on thought or anything? Are there any questions that you guys just had?
Like
anything out you and
weird stuff
in
Zala
land out there, Zoom land?
Or even deals that you have like going on now. It's okay that we can choose that.
But
not,
you know from
it's
now
okay,
on.
Just,
no, kidding.
But you can still ask the question. I'm on a buyer's agent for some reason. I don't know why.
You know what? Most agents are like that.
Yeah.
That you just quit, you know?
Yeah,
like I somehow got in with investors.
I had an investor years ago, and after that
yeah.
One investor, I'm like, I don't want to say
that. I've had to fire you. But no, it's, you know, this business alone is just difficult.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's just difficult.
Well,
so you want to work with people you like.
Yeah. And
then you can call and go, hey, what's going on?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And
it's not necessarily difficult. It's just for, because she's really it's not necessarily.
I think it's like such a process.
It's
exactly.
A lot
more you know, and like
yeah.
More people that you
absolutely.
Know are in a position,
mm-hmm.
It makes it
yeah.
Easier. And the more deals you
yeah.
Close.
And surround
yeah.
Yourself with people
yeah.
That you trust.
Yeah.
And find a title company that you
yeah.
Like, that you can just shoot an email
yeah.
To going, hey, this is what's going on.
Right.
Is this cool?
Yeah.
Find another agent that you can say,
right.
Hey, this is what's going on with the contract. Because that's what's
yeah.
Going to
yeah.
Be successful.
Yeah.
I mean, seriously.
Self with a good team.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
And that's what's gonna build you up.
Yeah. And anytime
yeah.
You can
yeah.
Pick up the phone and call, because even that
yeah.
That Blackstone buyer,
yeah.
I picked up the phone. I took them a minute to answer. But again, when you have a team of people, you know,
yeah.
Person they
yeah.
Your team is always it's,
yeah.
It could be a win-win for both sides.
Absolutely.
Right.
Yeah, that's one of the
yeah.
Conveniences of
yeah.
The, your position as a realtor. You don't have to know, you just
yeah.
Have to know.
Right. Yeah.
There you go. I like that.
Yeah.
That's a thing. Says like, if I don't know the answer, I know somebody that
knows
I can call
yeah.
Who knows me.
Yeah.
You should see us in the office. Hey, has anybody had this?
Or just like, or
is
she not
working?
Like,
yeah.
Yeah. Does anybody have an
yeah.
Email for this home warranty rip? Does
yeah.
Anybody
or
have an email for this?
Yeah.
Who's had an IRS payoff?
Yeah. What do we do now?
But we do the same thing. So
yeah.
I call market all the time.
Yeah.
It's crazy because a lot of everything's like case by case.
It is.
It's
it
the
is.
Same thing,
it's
but
same
it's
thing,
also
but
different.
Yeah, I like it. It looks different.
It's fun.
Yeah. Yeah.
It
is. It
stays interesting. You'll never
yeah.
Get bored.
Yeah.
Which is
yeah.
Nice. That's why I like it. And if
so,
you like people, you'll be fun.
Right.
Yeah, I was going to say, tomorrow
pickleball.
We're
going
to
play. Oh, yeah. Come play pickleball with us tomorrow.
And pickleball.
Oh, I'm competitive. We will not take
yeah.
You.
It's inside.
Yes, it's inside.
And there'll be food and drinks and a lot of the people there. So if y'all want to cut, just come on.
Just
you
come.
Ours, just
come.
It'd be really fun. For Zoom land, pickleball tomorrow.
Pickleball tomorrow.
We'll hang out the thing. Yeah.
You need to hold this up for
yeah,
the...
If anybody wants anything,
we can
give a copy to Shane.
Oh, another thing I was going to say, I forgot.
She's got a thumbs up back there. It's going out.
I also do like little mini info reels on Instagram. So if you want to follow me on @closingwithKathleen, I have like why to please never use a quick claim deed. Like who to put the seller on a contract. Like kind of some of the stuff we went over today, but just in little like 1 minute, 2 minute bites.
Closing
with Kathleen.
@closingwithKathleen.
And you'll see the pink jacket.
Signature color.
So, and it's just a good way to like kind of, I think it's good to have somebody from it, like get a home warranty rep, get a 1031 exchange person, get a loan officer and follow them. And because, you know, we're always sharing information, like with the NAR settlement and MUD disclosures, like it's something new's coming up every couple of months, it feels like lately. And that way you have people who are saying like, hey, did y'all see this? Like, you need to make sure that you're doing this. Like, did y'all,
yeah.
You know, or, you know, we'll share, we find a new resource. Like,
yeah.
did y'all know about this website? You know, like send me a message and I'll send it to you. It's just a good way to stay up to date and, you know, be the best resource for your client as well.
Sure. Guys, anything else?
Any questions?
Good. Thanks so much for having us, you guys.
Thank you
for
having us. Thank you. All right. Thank you all for joining today. We are going to go ahead and end today's training.
Our emails are there.
Y'all have a good day.
Bye. And
that
was 24/7. My cell number, I literally,
my cell number is not.